God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to
face tomorrow. One day we get to heaven, I'm going to be able to sing like that too. Amen. What about y'all? Amen. Won't that be good? You won't find any better singing than that right there, I promise you. Don't matter where you go in this world, that was good. I appreciate it. Glad that he's alive. What about you? Amen. Well, good to be in the house of God today. Turn in your Bibles to the book of James, chapter number 1 this morning. The book of James, chapter number 1. I apologize for my absence last week, and we kind of thought we were about to get hit by a couple storms there, and it looked like we were. And so last Sunday, kind of in a last-minute scramble, I was trying to get everything tied up and everything fixed, and we thought we were really fixing to catch it. And, well, we didn't get anything. Monday it was sunshine and got a little bit of rain, and I thank God for that. And I wouldn't want that to go anywhere. Wouldn't want that kind of destruction. Don't wish that upon anybody. And where it hit over there, we need to pray for those people as they recover. We've been in that situation before, and that's not a fun situation to be in. It was 15 years ago yesterday that we were all in that situation. And so pray for those over there working. Before we get here, do pray for Miss Rochelle Smith. That's Joe Smith's wife. She had a bad wreck this past week. I talked with Joe again yesterday, and she was hurt pretty badly. She was there in Gulfport. They had to do some internal surgery, which they got that fixed. I'm not sure what all that entailed, but she's still got a long road. Her pelvic has to be reconstructed. She did have a little bit of blood on her brain still. And so, Ms. Rochelle, they come here. And so, if you would, be sure to write their name down, Rochelle, and pray for them this week. Pray that God would give her quick healing. I don't want to miss anybody. I know a lot of folks have prayer requests, and you got a special thing you'd like to be prayed for. You might want to say, preacher, you just pray for us, church, pray for us, and we'll make it known that way. I'm still in the book of Judges. I will be back there. I've got a whole sermon prepared about Gideon, about God's approach to Gideon, about Gideon's apprehension, how he didn't think he had what it took, and then Gideon's analysis as he laid out a fleece. I have that prepared this week. But as I went back to my study again last night, I just didn't have peace about it. I just didn't feel like, although I felt like that was a good sermon, I didn't feel like that's where I should go. And when I sat back down, the Lord kind of led me over in this direction. And these are very familiar verses, but I do believe that this is what the Lord would have for us today. Difference in between a message and a sermon. Do y'all know that? Amen. There is a difference between a message and a sermon. And perhaps this is for me. I've got some decisions that I'm needing to make. And perhaps this passage is just for me, but I feel like it would be for others also. The book of James, chapter number 1. When you get there, say amen. All right. Stand, if you would, to honor the reading of the Word of God, if you're able this morning. And I'll begin reading in verse number... Let's begin reading in verse number 3. The Bible says in James chapter 1, verse 3, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work. You realize there's something working while you have to wait. Amen. So let patience have her perfect work. And here's why, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Wouldn't that be a good place to be today? Now, I don't think that you and I have reached sinless perfection yet, but we will one day. Amen. But we can be perfect in that we have a perfect desire, mature, complete in Christ. We be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. And then he says in verse number 5, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God, that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man that waves, let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. Let's pray and then I'll preach. Father in heaven, we bow again before you this morning. And God, we do thank you, God, for your presence in our lives. God, we thank you, God, for this church, for these people that are assembled here. God, we thank you for the opportunity to worship in freedom today. God, we thank you for the ability to assemble together. And God, come together in your name. God, to sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. God, to look to you. God, to open up our hearts and our minds in a place, God, where we're comfortable. God, we thank you for this place. God, we pray that you'd put it in our hearts to never take this place for granted. God, we pray that you'd put it in us and instill it in us that, God, this is a special place. And God, we come to this place today with reverence for you, God, high and lifted up above us all. And God, in this time and day that we live in, it's not caught you by surprise, but God, you see it all. And God, I pray today, God, that you would give us wisdom. God, I ask you for it. God, I believe in you for it. I ask you, God, to guide our hearts and our minds in days to come. God, I ask you to give us the strength and even the abilities, God, to know right from wrong, to discern truth from a lie. God, I pray that in the days to come, God, that you'd set this church upon yourself, the rock. And God, let us be a lighthouse in a lost and a dying world. God, I confess today my inability before these people and before you. And God, ask you today for your touch. Guide my tongue and my heart. God, let everything that's said be edifying unto Jesus Christ. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. You can be seated. Charles Haddon Spurgeon said, he was asked, what he thought the most important and the most needed thing was in the church. And he said that it's not for more preachers. He said, because the bushes are full of preachers. But Charles Haddon Spurgeon said that the most important thing is for people that know how to pray. People that know how to get a hold of God and people that know how to ask. The most important thing, I think, today, considering the times and the days that you and I live in, are for people that know how to pray. If I asked you today, how's your prayer life? Honestly, I'm not asking you to answer that out loud. I wouldn't do that. But if I ask you today, over the past 6 days, how much you've prayed, how much that you've really took some time to seek the Lord's face and to seek the Lord's will, what would that answer be? Would it be that we've spent an hour a day or 5 minutes a day? Or would it be that we'd have to honestly say there's some days that go by that we haven't really bended our knee at all? We complain about a lot and we pray about nothing. We complain about the situation of everything around us, but yet we don't pray about it. We talk about what's going on in Washington. We talk about what's going on in the streets all over the world, the mobs and the killings and what's going on with the Democratic Party, what's going on with the Republican Party. But yet we hadn't prayed about anything. We're silent when it comes to that. We've got this mindset that somehow God will just fix it all without us asking. And so I would agree with Spurgeon to say that the most important thing in this day is for people that know how to pray. The Bible gives us a promise here in James chapter number 1, verse number 5. And this promise is so pervasive if I could. It's so clear that I think that if we, anybody in their right mind, would read this verse in its context and understand what God is saying to us in this verse, I don't think any of us would want to do without it. I mean, look at what your Bible says. Do you have a Bible this morning? Amen. And look at what he says in verse number 5. Such a powerful verse. He says, if any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to some men, to give it to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. I don't think there's one person in their right mind here today that would want to do without that. I mean, who doesn't want God's wisdom? Who doesn't want God's mind on things? Who doesn't want God's heart on things? But yet, we haven't asked for it. When's the last time that you honestly bowed before God and said, God, I need you. I want to know your mind, your heart. I want to know what you would have for my life, not what I've got planned for my life. Because sometimes God's will interrupts our plans, does it not? Sometimes God's will takes us on a different path than we planned on going. But the only true joy that a Christian will ever find is in the will of God. Why is it that we want to walk down our own road and our own path and do our own things when God said, if you'll just ask me, I'll show you what I have for you? Who wouldn't want that this morning? You know, when you got saved, God gave you some incredible things. Amen. When you got saved, there's some incredible things happened in your life. Number one, when you got saved, your sins were forgiven. Amen. How many of you glad of that this morning? Amen. That your sins were forgiven. If there was nothing else that accompanied salvation than the simple fact that you got your sins forgiven, that would be enough. Amen. The very simple fact that today that your name's written down in the Lamb's Book of Life, that they're removed as far as the east is from the west, that to be remembered no more, that when God looks up on your record, he sees your own blood. And when you got saved, your sins got forgiven. Though they were many, they were washed with scarlet and came out white as snow. You got saved, your sins got forgiven. When you got saved, you become heaven bound. We sang about that today. Isn't that a good thing? Amen. And one day, Brother Dustin, you're going to go to heaven. Amen. One day, faith will become sight. The things that you've preached about, you'll no longer be just speaking about things, but you'll be seeing those things. Isn't that a wonderful thing? And you know, the good thing about heaven is when we go there, Brother Darrell, that we're not going as guests, we're going as family. Amen. Now, there's a difference between guest and family, right? Any of you are welcome at my house anytime, but you're a guest, amen. But I've got four sons that they're my family. And when they come home, it's a little bit different, amen. They have full right and reins of the refrigerator and the pantry and the cabinets and the toilet paper and more toilet paper. And they got full reins to everything that is in that house because they're family. And when we go to heaven one day, we're not going as guests, amen. We're going as family. Our names are written down there. They've got a room for me, a mansion for me, a home for me in heaven one day. And I'll not be treated as a stranger or an alien. I'm part of the family of God. Isn't that wonderful? Amen. You got saved. God took this old dirty past that you had and erased it. I mean, isn't that a wonderful thing? All the things that you ever committed and thought about committing, God said, I'll put them under the blood to be remembered no more, and I'll not stop there, but I'll give you a home in heaven one day. You don't have to worry about when you close your eyes in death, whatever day that might be, that as soon as you close your eyes in death, to be absent from the body will be to be present with the Lord, and you'll be welcomed then as the Father welcomed home the prodigal into the family and the household of God. Amen. By the way, while I'm preaching, that isn't just reserved for Baptists, amen. That's reserved for everybody that's bowed the knee to Christ and confessed Him as Lord and been washed in the blood of Jesus, His own begotten Son. Amen. Oh, yes. Well, you got saved. Your sins got forgiven. And you're not only just saved, you're heaven bound, amen. And then thirdly, when you got saved, the Spirit of God dwells in you. Can you imagine that? How many of you saved and you know it? Yes. And today that you're saved and you know it, and God's given you this promise that you have this treasure in earthen vessels, in jars of clay, that God Himself tabernacles inside of you, that He lives in you. The creator of all the universe, the creator of a round earth or a flat earth. No, I'm just kidding. Inside joke right there. The creator of all the universe lives in you. And as that vessel is broken, that light shines out of it. Jars of clay. But the Spirit of God lives in you. You were saved. You were forgiven. You were given a home. You were given a family. But yet we also, fourthly, have this promise in James chapter number 1. That while you're in this life, God says, if you lack wisdom, if you lack wisdom, if you don't know what to do, and you don't know when to do it, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and God will give it. Why are we so worried as Christians? Why is it that, sure it's quiet. Why is it that we fret about so much when God said, if you'll just ask me, I'll give it to you. Now what you ask God for, you might not always get. You do realize that sometimes the answer is no. But God says, you'll never ask me for wisdom. You'll never ask me for my mind and my heart that I won't give it to you. Imagine that. Every problem that we have is contained in James chapter 1, verse number 5. God said, I'll give it to you. James is the half-brother of Jesus. Can you imagine growing up in the same house as Jesus? Can you imagine your mother looking at you and saying, why can't you be like your brother, Jesus? But yet the half-brother of Jesus is inspired by God to give us this verse. Believe all the Word of God's inspired, don't you? God breathed, God given, and the half-brother of Jesus give us this verse. He says, if you'll just ask me, you got it. I'll do it. I'll ask you a question this morning. Do you have the wisdom of God? God said, I'll give you wisdom with no limitations. I'll give you wisdom before I'll give you anything else. God said, I'll give you the ability to understand and to know. I'll do it if you just ask. Do you remember David had a son and his name was Solomon? And God said, ask me one thing and I'll do it for you. You remember that? He got that one request that we all think about sometimes, and he says, ask me for what? And he could have asked for cattle, he could have asked for land, he could have asked for all that, but Solomon said, Lord, give me wisdom. Know how to go in and out among your people, that I may know how to rule well and do right. And God said, because you asked me for wisdom, he said, I'm going to give it to you, and I'm going to give you all the other stuff too. God said, I'll do it if we'll just ask. But yet there's so many decisions that I make every day without the wisdom of God. I really shouldn't be worried about what the New Orleans Saints are doing on a practice field. I really shouldn't be worried about what the media is covering if I've got the wisdom of God. There's three keys here found in these verses to the wisdom of God that I want you to see. Does anybody need to know the heart of God about something? Yeah. The first key to heaven-sent wisdom, I like to say, is probably the toughest key. But number one, you've got to acknowledge that you lack wisdom. Yeah. He said here that if any man, any of you, lack wisdom. Now, how many of you want heaven's wisdom? How many of you want that? Yeah. The Bible says the first thing you got to do is acknowledge that, God, I lack wisdom. We may fool others when it comes to this wisdom thing, but the truth is, we're not fooling God. That's We may make everybody think we really know we got it. I was talking to a guy the other day. We was just talking about life and talking about things and going on. And we were just talking about different things that we had been through. And he said, man, he looked over at me and he said, man, you got it figured out, don't you? And I said, oh, no, That's the furthest thing from my mind. I said, it might sound like I have it figured out, but I wish I could live all the things that I just told you. So we might fool everybody, but we haven't fooled God. You see, God knows whether you've got wisdom or not. What good is it if you've got everybody around you fooled that you've got the heart of God? At the same time, God's looking at you saying, you don't know nothing of me. You don't know anything that I want. You're not living in my will. You're not going in the right way. When is the last time in honesty that you bended your knee before God and looked up to heaven and said, God, I don't know what I'm doing? When's the last time when it come to your home or your family or whatever it is, your job, just everything in general, that you look to God and said, God, I lack. I don't know what to do. I don't know where to go. God, I don't know the things I ought to say. God, I need wisdom. I lack. Now the world says don't ever do that. That's what the world says. Don't ever let anybody know that you don't know what you're doing, right? The world says if you don't know what you're doing, just act like you know what you're doing. I was 18 years old. I went to work for a company on shutdowns and paper mills, and all I wanted to do was work, you know. And I remember I went into that little office, and they said, well, what do you know? And I said, well, I could probably tell you what I don't know quicker than I could tell you what all I do know, you know. I think every 18-year-old's that way, ain't they? Amen. And they said, well, we got a job as a millwright, and we got a job as an oiler. And I said, how much does the millwright make? Well, he makes about $28 an hour. How much does the oiler make? Well, he makes about $18 an hour. I said, I'm a millwright. Sounded right to me, didn't it, you? And they said, well, okay, all right. Well, you hired on as a millwright. I showed up at the very first paper mill up there in Grenada, Mississippi, and the guy come out at this little forklift. He said, where's your tools? All I had was a carpenter bag. I said, I didn't bring them with me. Just acting like I knew, you know. Got in that plant that night. They gathered us up. We had a little safety meeting. They said, all right, this millwright, this is your job. This is what you got to do. And I'm going to tell you the truth, I didn't have one idea how to do any of them things they said. I just acted like I knew. And so a lot of us, when it comes to this thing called wisdom, we just think that the world thinks, you better not ever confess your weakness. You better not ever tell anybody what you don't know. But God says just the opposite. God says if you want what I've got, you've got to confess to me what you don't have. God, I lack. So we play this game of fooling everybody, and we end up fooling our own selves. I lack. God says if you want my wisdom, you've got to be honest with me. Now don't confuse wisdom with knowledge, because the two aren't the same thing. You can be knowledgeable about a lot of things. You can be knowledgeable about a car or mechanics or carpentry you can be knowledgeable about medical field and all these other things. But knowledge and wisdom is two different things. Knowledge is knowing a lot about something. Wisdom is knowing how to use what you know. Amen. One preacher said this, that wisdom is knowing what to do and when to do it. Boy, that would solve a lot of things for me if I just knew when I should do what. When people call you in the middle of the night, or people call you in the evening and you're on your way home as a pastor, and they call you and they want to talk to you, they don't say, Brother Brad, I just called you to hear all that you know. They say, Brother Brad, I need to know what to do. And 8 times out of 10, I've got to say, I don't know either. But I'll tell you what we'll do. We'll confess it to God and we'll pray about it. and we'll find out what God's will is for it. If any man lack, let him ask of God. I thought about this passage of Scripture. I heard David Gibbs preach on this passage of Scripture, and when he did, he gave the illustration of his grandpa, and I felt like I ought to include it. David Gibbs is an attorney. He's a Christian attorney, and he's from up in Cleveland, Ohio. He's a tremendous person to hear preach. He's pretty awesome. And he said this. He said that his grandpa, after he was in the eighth grade three times, he decided he wasn't going to go back no more. Amen. And so what his grandpa did was his grandpa, he quit school in the eighth grade, and he said he went out one day. What he knew how to do was to butcher cows. He said so his grandpa went out one day. He bought a cow. He went out and he butchered it. He brought it back to town and he sold the cow. He worked out a deal with a farmer. Didn't have enough money to buy the cow. He worked out a deal with a farmer, got the cow, came back, butchered the cow, gave the farmer his part, sold the cow, went back and got another cow. And he said a few days later, one day after another, one cow became two cows, and then two cows became three cows. Three cows became five cows. He just was doing what he knew to do, and before long, he had a slaughterhouse in Cleveland, Ohio, and they were butchering 5,000 to 7,000 cows a day. And he said every morning his grandpa would get up, Brother Darrell, and this is what he'd pray. He said he'd always do two things every time he ever heard him pray. He said, first of all, he'd say, Lord, this is Earl. He said, Grandpa, why do you tell God your name? You know, he said, because that's my name. He said, he found so much sense in that. You know, I mean, you tell God, this is Earl. And he said, and the very next thing that he'd say was, God, this is Earl. Lord, I lack. I lack. God, I don't know how to do it. And God, I don't know what to do. God, I've got 1,000 men working for me, and I lack. If any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally. Number one, that is the first key. You've got to acknowledge that you lack. Most of us don't want to do that. And instead of asking, we try to cover what we need to do with some kind of skill set we have, you know, something that we're good at. We'll try to make everybody believe that. But the truth is about this passage of Scripture is there's no greater power that you and I can access into than the minute that we get honest with God and just say, God, I lack. Yeah. When's the last time that you told God you just didn't know? He said his grandpa got called up to New York, and he said they brought him in with the Secretary of Trade. They were, this is not my story, this is his. They were selling 3 million patties to McDonald's every week. 3 million hamburger patties to McDonald's every week. And so they called him in, the Secretary of Trade. He said, so his grandpa called him up and said, Davy, they want to meet with me up there in New York, and I'm scared of those people. I want you to go with me. He said, okay, Grandpa, I'll go. And so he went with his grandpa. He said, we walked into the Twin Towers. They were still standing, walked into this room. He said, here come 125 men in with and assistants and women and all in suits and ties and their computers and their laptops. And he said, here me and my grandpa sat in that room by ourselves. And they walk in, he said, and they sat there, and for an hour and a half they badgered everything they could do. They argued back and forth and contradicted one another back and forth and talked about this and talked about that. And he said, after about an hour and a half, the main one stood up and said, Mr. Gibbs, do you understand anything that we're saying? He looked at him and he said, no. And he said, and after listening to you for the last hour and a half, I don't think you understand what you're saying either. Grandpa said, here's what I'm going to do. He said, I'm going to get up from here, and I'm going to go back to my car, and I'm going to go back to where I live in Ohio. He said, and I'm going to go buy some more cows, and I'm going to go butcher some more cows, and I'm going to keep on doing what I'm doing, and I'm leaving my grandson here, and whatever you say, he'll take care of, and what he says is good with me. He says, but if I sit here and listen to y'all, y'all don't have a clue what y'all doing. So when you figure out what you want to do, just let me know. His grandpa got back in the car and he left. And David Gibbs said for about 30 minutes, they just sat there and looked at each other and said, that man just mocked us, made a fool out of us right here in front of everybody. That man exposed our weaknesses. It's just wisdom. Lord, I lack. Boy, it's something to get before God and to confess all your faults and failures, but it's another thing to get before God and say, God, I really don't know what to do. Let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally. Number one, you've got to acknowledge that you lack. Number two, you've got to ask and receive. Notice what he said in verse number 5. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of God. That word ask is in the continuum sense, which means to not just ask, but to ask and keep asking. This is not a one-time thing that you just go before the Lord and say, God, I don't know what to do and get up. But this is, it gives the sense that to weary your king, to pray and keep praying, to ask and keep asking, to confess and keep confessing, to not let a day go by that you don't get before God and say, God, I need to know what you would have me to do with my life. God, I lack wisdom. I don't know what you're facing. I don't know what decision that you have to make this morning. I've got a few on my plate that I need to be praying about. I've got a few things in my life personally that I really, really, really need to be getting the heart of God about. And I don't know about you or what it is that you're facing, but God said in this verse, if you'll ask me, I'll let you know how to do it. How else do you take a man and walk into a room of 125 lawyers and let him get up and walk out and leave them astounded? It's the heart and the wisdom of God. Ask for it. He said he gives it to all men liberally, not just in little bits, but God said, I'll give you wisdom in bunches. He said, I'll unload heaven on you. I'll let you know what my will is for your life. I'm not sure how we can live his will or even say that we're in the will of God when we haven't even asked. James later on says, you have not because you... But you ask and you ask amiss that you may consume it upon your own lust. How can we even say as a Christian that we're in the will of God when we ain't even asked God what his will is? There's no educational criteria for wisdom. Amen. I've met people with D, 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 D behind their name, and they were educated idiots for real. There is no educational criteria for the wisdom of God. Now, you might be a whole lot smarter than me or anybody else, and I'm sure you'll be the one to tell everybody that, too. There's no grade level for wisdom. It's the heart and the mind of God. The one who sits upon the earth is as his footstool. Can you imagine that? The one who holds it into orbit and holds every star in place, he says, I'll tell you what to do. Ask me, and I'll give it to you. You got to acknowledge that you lack. Number two, you got to ask and receive. He said in verse number 6, but let him ask how? In. Y'all read it with me. Verse number 6. Come on now. But let him ask, how? In faith. Oh my. He said, you want it? You want to know the heart and the mind of God? Let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. Let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. God says, if you're one of those that ask and don't believe, if you're looking to God, but yet with doubt, he said, you won't get any of this. He said, but you've got to ask knowing. Do we really believe that God will? Word faith, I've heard it broke down like this, that for all I trust him. I think that's a good acrostic. For all I trust him. I think that's a good explanation of faith. We know that faith cometh by hearing. Y'all, if y'all don't do it, I'll say it three times until you say it with me. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And let him ask in faith. You know what that means? That you somewhere in your life that you've got in your Bible and you've got a hold of a promise of God. I want you to know the book that you hold is more than just leather and paper or whatever it is. It is the living, inspired word of God. You open it up and God will come out of it. Amen. He said, let him ask in faith. Let him ask according to the word of God. You get in the word of God, you find out the heart and the mind of God. Let him ask according to the word of God. Have you ever prayed and scripture began to come to your mind and you knew that you were praying according to the word of God? And when you ask in faith, he said, look out now. I'm going to give it to you. David Gibbs said that his grandpa called him in the office one day and said, David, we've done something wrong. And he said, what are you talking about? He said, Grandpa, he said, David, we bought these cattle too cheap. Imagine that. Amen. He said, we bought these cattle too cheap. He said, this ain't right. We stole these cattle from this man. He said, this ain't right, David. He said, Grandpa, nobody else bid on the cattle, whatever, however that deal went down. He said, we didn't do anything illegal. He said, but it ain't right. He said, it ain't right. He said, David, we're Christians. And just because it's legal don't make it right. Amen. He said, now David, here's what I want you to do. I want you to take this envelope of money. I want you to drive to that man's house as fast as you can. And I want you to give this money back to this man. We're going to pay that man for what it's worth.
Yeah.
And he said, now you be careful with it. There's $30,000 in that envelope. He took the $30,000, drove through the snow, drove through the night, drove up to the man's little house on his farm, walked up to the window, knocked on the door. His wife come out. His husband come out. He said, I was in a suit and tie. He said, I'm David Gibbs. My grandpa owns a such and such meat company there in Cleveland, Ohio. And he said, we bought these cattle from you. My grandpa says we didn't pay you enough, and he wants to pay you what they were worth. The woman looked at him and said, sir, what kind of man does that? He said, my grandpa told me to tell you that we're Christians.
Amen. Lord God.
Let him ask in faith. He said, Grandpa, why would you do that? He said, son, have you not learned that you cannot outgive God when you do what's right? When you do what's right. He said, I prayed, I asked. That's what God told me to do. You ask in faith. Now that's the thing. The problem with heaven-sent wisdom is it no longer becomes your mind, but it becomes God's mind. You see, you can't do what you want to do when you pray for wisdom. That's the problem. If it had been most of us, we'd probably pocketed that $30,000 and kept it and counted it off as a good deal. But when you say, God, I lack, and I need to know what you want, you're fixing to find out what God wants out of your life.
Yeah.
And the problem is that what he wants isn't always what we want. Most of the time, it's the total opposite than what we want. But when you ask for God's wisdom, he said, I'll give it to you. Ask in faith, believing. When you ask for God's wisdom, you better be ready to do what God tells you to do. He might tell you to get up and preach. Amen. God's still calling preachers. I don't think we're so far gone that he can call nobody else to preach. More than likely, I don't know the odds of it, more than likely some of these young men called to preach. Some of y'all called to preach, you just won't tell nobody about it. You better not pray about it because God might have you preach it. He might tell you to go home. He might tell you to quit your job. He might tell you to give somebody some money. He might tell you to go somewhere you don't want to go. He might tell you to love somebody that you really don't feel like loving. He might tell you to give compassion where you really don't want to give compassion. But if any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not. And let him ask in faith, believing. And when you ask, God's going to give it to you. And God's heart isn't always what our heart is. There was a difference about King David. He was a man after God's own heart. And you'll find out that David wasn't afraid to admit when he was wrong. Oh, he had mistakes, but yet he would confess it to God and get it back right with God. You better be ready when you pray and you ask because God's going to tell you what he wants you to do. Do you want God's wisdom?
Yeah.
Acknowledge that you lack. Number two, ask and keep asking. You say, well, I prayed about it one time back 2 or 3 years ago. Pray again. Pray again. Well, I asked the Lord, you know, last week, pray again. You knock, keep knocking. Ask and keep asking. Seek and keep seeking. Well, I asked God to reveal himself to me one time, ask him again. I asked God to show me the truth one time, ask him again. A lot of our quarrels with different people would really be solved if we'd pray about it. Because sometimes God's going to reveal it to us that it's us, not them. Any man ask, God will give it to him. Liberally, he said. Now look in verse number 7. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the Lord. I want to live this life God's way, don't you? Man, I'm too far. I think I'm over halfway through this thing. I ain't really sure, but I think I am. I think I'm halfway through this thing, and I don't want to live the last half like I did the first half. I want to live it for God. I've got so many blunders and mistakes and decisions I've made. I mean, I bought a Dodge truck one time. Let him ask. I heard the story told. It's a lot of stories been told several times about a man by the name of Carl Smith. His wife's name was Anna. They surrendered to go to the mission field. This will help you. They surrendered to go to the mission field, and it wasn't long after they surrendered to go to the mission field, Anna Smith came down sick, which prevented them from going. So they were at home, and they began to pray and believe, James chapter 1, verse number 5. And they began to ask God what it was, how he could use them in the ministry, in the situation they was in. Carl Smith was not an educated man. He started his shop out in a garage with a dirt floor, with an extension cord, run from his house out to his shop, and he began to pray. And as he began to pray, James 1:5, he told the Lord, this is what I'm going to do. If I can't go to the mission field, I'm going to give 9/10 of my money to missionaries. Somebody asked him one time, says, was you nervous about that? He said, you better believe I was nervous. He said, you better believe I didn't know where it was going to come from or how it was going to happen. Carl Smith ended up inventing some kind of little special antenna that goes on different airplanes and different things. It went all through the military. They began to put it on their helicopters and all that. And he became very wealthy, but the whole time he never stopped giving 9/10 of his money to missionaries. Somebody asked him one time, they said, Carl, just, you know, how many it is. Somebody told me that you supported 200 missionaries. He says, as of right now, he said, I fully support, not contribute to. He said, I fully support 400 missionaries on my own.
Wow. Amen.
It started in a garage.
Amen.
With a man saying, God, if you'll do it, I'll do it. God, if you'll show me, I'll walk in that light and do what it is that you called me to do. And he said, it is my prayer. Anna was dead by then, and he said, it is my prayer. Before I go on to meet Jesus, I'd love to be supporting 1,000.
Amen.
Let him ask. Let him ask. Do you have a situation in your life you don't know what to do? You got a situation in your life right now you really don't know what to do? Man, I know how it gets. Look, you feel so pressed. You've got children and jobs and ministry. Look, man, if anybody knows this, I do know this. You've got responsibilities and debts and bills that you've made that we brought on ourselves. Say amen right there.
Yeah.
Nobody forced us into that. We done it ourselves. We wanted something. We went out and we reap what we sow. That ain't popular preaching, but that's the truth. We reap in what we sow. We sow to the world, sow the wind and reap the whirlwind. And so we get ourselves in such a predicament that our hands are tied and we feel like that we're bound to this world and there ain't nothing we can do and there'll never be no joy come from any of it. Say amen right there. How do you know that, Brother Brad? Because I'm there, been there. And God said, if you'll just ask me. Now, I'm just afraid of what God might say. That's just honesty.
Yeah.
Just afraid of what God might tell me to do. But if we'll ask, he said, I'll give it to you. How many of you want the wisdom of God?
Amen.
Well, this isn't about Gideon. I wanted to preach to you about Gideon. And I'll go back to the book of Judges next Sunday. Brother Darrell said, you don't ever preach out of the New Testament. So there you go, brother. I heard Brother Brett preach a wonderful service last Sunday. I heard it. I heard he preached Jesus, man. I heard he did a tremendous job. Wonderful preacher, Brother Brett is, him and his family. He's down preaching at Community Baptist Church this morning, his home church, y'all's home church, down there getting a minister. Prophets without honor in his own country. It's a hard place to go, but he's down there preaching the Word of God to him this morning. I'm thankful. I heard he did good. So there's a New Testament sermon. Here's the question. Will you ask? Will you ask? We complain about nothing, everything, and pray about nothing.